Let me take you over here. Assume we have a simple beam. This may be the PCAS, P-stasis concrete beam. And this is a part of a beam in the bridge. There are the other beam also, okay? And typically, the beam will be subjected to series of loading. If there is a pickup, there are two wheels that's going to move along this bridge, okay? If there are 10 wheelers, you may have a series of three wheel move content, okay? If it's 18 wheelers, that's going to be five. The problem is, when you design the beam subjected to the vehicle load is the movable load. So the concept of drawing that shear diagram and moment diagram may not be appropriate for the design of this kind of beam. So that is the professor offer us the concept of influence size, okay? And then we can use three methods to draw the influence line. One, as you may know, just put the load over here, do the calculation for the reaction of A sub Y, if you prefer to draw the influence line of A sub Y. Then again, you move it to, for example, 2 meters, analyze the structure between A sub Y, put it in the table. Move it over here, analyze for the A sub Y, put it in the table. Move it over here, analyze the beam for the A sub Y, put it in the table, and move it like this one. This method, you're going to get the value of A sub Y and also B sub Y, and put it in the table, and then you can draw the inference line. Then there is another concept, put the load over here, 1 unit load. Okay, and then set the distance between the reference to the point load to be x, and then you analyze the structure for the A sub y equation, and also for the B sub y equation. You plot the diagram basis on the obtained equation from 0, 2 meter, 4 meter, 6 meter, as you did on the first method. This is more convenient, but it's still not that good, okay? Until Professor Muller observed one thing, if we like to draw A sub Y, just release the resistance of A sub Y. Why? Because he like to apply by the A sub Y and move this one up for 1 unit. And you can see over here, it's going to be the rotating point, okay? Then you obtain what? The same inference line of the first and second method, in which this is going to be 1.0. Half of this is going to be 0.5. And then over here, it's going to be 0 by the same concept. If you like to draw the inference line of B sub Y, A sub Y be the same. Release the resistance of B sub Y and move it up for 1 unit, okay? You obtain the inference line of what? Of B sub Y. And you can see the inference over here gonna be positive. Have the maximum value 1.0 over here, 0.5 at the midspan, and 0 over here. And then due to the inference line is positive, all of that, if you have uniformly distributed load, just put it across the span, you will get the maximum B sub Y. And the same one, you have this kind of inference line A sub Y, the same loading pattern provide the maximum A sub Y. Now, let me move you to the inference line of shear force. Inference line of shear force is gonna be a bit complicated. Let me put this one for another part of the beam. Actually, it's going to be the same beam, but I'm going to do modification because that is unnecessary. If you like to determine the inference line of shear, release the resistance of shear. That means you got to put this one move up and down, also this one move up and down, and positive shear. positive here. Downward is positive. Upward on the right hand side is positive. Okay, on the left, downward positive. On the right, upward is positive. So by doing this one, release the resistance to the shear force. Let the shear move it up. Okay, so you will get this kind of shape. And this is going to be the inference line of the shear. Okay, if the projector ruler have the length of A, the coordinate over here gonna be minus A over the total span. And if this black carbon plate have the length of B, okay, this is going to be the coordinate of B over L. B over L is positive. A over L over here gonna be negative. Okay, and by the same concept, if we would like to draw the inference line of the moment, you change that point to be the internal pin and apply the positive moment, lift it up. Okay, then the movement of my finger is gonna be AB over L, and the relative angle over here is gonna be 1.0 unit. Okay, 1.0 unit, no radian, no degree, 1.0 unit. And this is the basic that Professor Musler proposed. And the same concept can apply to any kind of simple beam or any kind of determinate beam. And as you said, during the deformation based on Muller Bessler principle, the member have rigid body movement. That's going to be a straight line. They always straight line, no curve at all. Okay, now, following what I'm proposing to you, let me show you some practice on the drawing of the inference line diagram of statically determinate beam and based on what Musler-Bessler principle. Let me take you over here. Over here, there is the statically determinate beam. If you have a chance to take a look at it, let me turn this one off first. Okay, it's going to be smaller file. The statically determinate over here have what? Pin, roller. So if you check for this structure, you have the unknown to be the force of what? The reactions. That's gonna be 2, 3, 4. That's gonna be 4 reactions. And for reaction, you have the hinge over here. You have 2 internal force. So the total unknown in combination is gonna be equal to 6. Then how many equations do you have? You have 2 parts of this one. This is going to be ABC portion. And also you have the second part for CDEFG. That means you have total of 2 free body diagram. So you have the number of equation of equilibrium equal to 2 times 3 equal to 6. They are equal. That's we said is statically determinate. And again, A is pin, D and F, the roller, and C is going to be internal hinge. We're going to draw the inference line of many things. Okay, first, A sub Y, okay? And then we got to draw the shear diagram of V sub D on the right. And then we may draw the M sub F. Okay, let me take you down first, the reaction first, okay? The reaction. Let me take you to the reaction. And let me say, we're going to do all the reaction. First, we start with A sub Y, okay? Muller's Bessler principle said, if you like to do the inference line of reaction, change that height. Okay, by release the resistance to A sub Y. So change the pin to this roller a sub x still there, okay, but there is no a sub y. This point is going to be roller. This point is going to be roller, and then this point is going to be hinge. What happened, kid? You're going to push this one up for 1.0 unit. Okay, let me put the scale 1.0 unit equivalent to 10 millimeter. So this one move for 1.0 unit. What happened? You got to use your imagine to thinking about it. This portion has support over here and over here. Okay. It cannot lift up this way to support. It cannot rotate. Okay. Understand that, right? There are two roller. It cannot move up and it cannot rotate. Then this is going to be the rotating point. This is going to be the rotating point. Then your inference line of A sub Y going to be like this one. Now, let me move you to the inference line of D sub Y. Okay, let me move you to inference line of D sub Y. If you prefer to draw the inference line of D sub Y is over here, A sub Y in, and F is going to be the same, and internal hinge going to be the same. Imagine, you're going to push this one up for 1 unit. Again, put it for 10 millimeter up for 1.0 unit. What happened? What happened? You have this one to be one piece, okay? This one to be one piece, I mean, this one is going to be the yellow, okay? Previous one, this one, the yellow. The yellow for this one won't move, but the yellow for this one got to what? Got to rotate about this point. So based upon this one, you have this one as the rotating point. And then you draw the line link between them. You got this yellow portion move. Okay. Then what happened? The light blue portion also move corresponding to that movement. So the second one, the light blue move, okay, following the first one. Okay. Now let me move you to another inference line. That's going to be the force F sub Y. Now you got to have this one as the pin. You got to have this one as the roller. You still have this one as the internal hinge. And you got to move this one up for 1 unit. The inference line of F sub Y, you got to push this one up for 1 unit. Then when you push this one up for 1.0 unit, what happened? Thinking about this one again. Okay, this is a piece of the beam. And then this is going to be what? The same thing. Rotating point. This is going to be rotating point. Then you got the line that's going to be corresponding to this one. And the hinge going to be here, okay? And then the light blue, this one going to move corresponding to the yellow movement. This going to be the rotating point. This also going to be rotating point. You get this one. So in conclusion, the inference line of statically determinate beam for the reaction always satisfied. You can dodge it by what? You can dodge it by releasing the resistance to reaction over here for A sub 1. And then based on this one, you got to think the beam have how many member? Okay, this beam have two member. And then you got to think this member can move? No, okay. When this one cannot move, there is a rotating point over here. The light blue gonna move up like this one. Okay. The same thing occur for the D sub Y. Release the resistance to D sub Y, push it up for 1 unit. Then thinking about the yellow portion, how it's gonna move? It's gonna rotate about this point. Then the yellow line change to this line. Okay. When the yellow line change to this line, the light blue, okay, gonna move up. Then the line gonna be like this one. Coming to the F sub Y, release the resistance to the F sub Y, push it up, okay, to 1 unit. Then thinking about this portion is have the rotating point over here. The yellow portion move, okay, like this one. So you get this line, and then after that you get this. Now, how do you determine the coordinate? Okay, like this one, this is 6 meter. Since this one is 1.0, you know this one gonna be 0.5. By what? If this one is 1 divided by 1 divided by 12, let's say this one equal to slope y divided by 6. So y is gonna be 6 over 12 is 0.5. You determine any coordinate of the inference line by using the proportion. The same thing over here. Over here, since this is 1.0, this is 6 meter. So you get this one to be minus 1. Okay. Because of what? 1 divided by 6. 1 divided by 6 equal to this one. Y divided by 6. So Y is going to be 1. But it's in the negative. So it's minus 1. And I know this one going to be the same. What? This is 6 meter. 1, let me put this one, y divided by 12 equal to 1 divided by 6. So y is going to be 12 over 6 is going to be plus 2. Okay. Okay. Anybody? Everybody? You got me, right? Then following this one. This one is 1. Divided by 6, this one gonna be minus 1 because it's also divided by 6. And the distance here is 12 meter. From here to here is 6 meter. So this is gonna be positive 2. Okay. Now, you draw the inference line of reaction. Let me move you to draw the inference line of the shear force. Okay, the basic one gonna be the shear force as point B. Okay, let me move you up over here. Again, the beam separate into the light blue. And then also the yellow have the hinge to join it. We gonna draw the inference line of V sub B. You like the inference line of V sub B. This is point B. Okay, this is point B. You're going to draw the inference line of shear force at point B. There is nothing about this one. Just keep it pin, keep it roller, keep it roller, and keep it internal hinge. When you're going to draw the inference line of shear force, release the resistance to the shear force. The way to release the resistance to the shear force, put the roller guide. You got to put the roller guide Okay, to release it, because the shear force has this kind of tri-conventional direction downward over here, upward over here. That's going to be the shear force. And also at this point, there is the positive moment also. You release the shear, you still have the resistance to the moment. Now, put the shear on the left hand side downward. Put the shear on the right hand side upward. Okay, and then you can see this is a portion of the beam that cannot move. There are two rollers over here. Then you got to do what? You got to consider the light beam. Now, this portion gonna be moved to minus A over L. And this portion gonna move up by plus B over L. Then based on this consideration of this portion, this is going to be the rotating point. This also gonna be the rotating point. This one won't move. So this one will move by the distance here of 6 meter and 6 meter. So the total span of this light blue portion in combination going to be 12. This is gonna be minus 6/12. This is gonna be minus 0.5. And this one is going to be also positive 0.5. So move down for half centimeter and move up for half centimeter. And the total of this one gonna be 1.0. And then the line between them gonna be in parallel. Okay, that is going to be the shear force at point B. Okay, now the problem asks you to draw the shear force at point D on the light. Okay, so don't worry, put the same thing. Pin, roller, internal, hinge. Okay, you consider at what? You consider at, no, on the light, not this one, it's wrong. On this one, this is on the left. Okay. We got to consider it on the light. Let me take this one out. We got to draw over here, okay, over here. It's gonna be point B, point D dot on the right hand side. So drawing the shear, put the roller guide over there, okay. Then there is the portion, yellow portion have been changed, okay? There is no continuity over here. And this one is gonna be the same. What's going to be the shear force? Now, the shear force gonna put in this downward on the left, okay? And then upward to the light. What happened, kid? Consider this one. This is going to be the rotating point. Okay, it's gonna move. And how about this one? This one can move. This one composed of two portions. Okay, it's going to be different when we just have this only one portion. If they are connected, no internal hinge, it cannot move, but this one now is moved. However, this is very small piece, okay? And then it, when it's moved, it's just provide the rotation. So this portion needs to move for 1.0 unit. And cause the rotating about point F to be something like this one. Okay. Now, you got to have very important thing, the slope. Okay. You got this one to be 1.0 s over here, but the slope over here and over here must be in parallel. Then this one must move up. Okay. And then following this one, this is going to be the rotating point. You have this kind of rotating of this member. Now, due to the proportion, this is 1/6. This is 6. This is -1. Okay. This is 6. This is 6. This is positive 1.0. That's going to be the inference line of V sub D R. Okay. Now, we may move to some important thing. For example, if we like to do the V sub D L. Okay. I'm going to provide that one for you. Now, what else we can do? That should have the inference line. Oh, okay, I can draw the inference line of V sub DL to show you. Let me put it over here. V sub DR, okay, V sub DL. We put it over here. If we like to put at the on the left, okay, let me put this one the same, this one the same. We going to draw the inference line of D, at point D, this one, V sub D L, okay, V sub D L, V sub D L. This one gonna be the same. Internal hinge gonna be the same. We just change this portion, cut it, and put the roller guide over here. Now, we put the roller guide over here. What happened here? This portion cut to be two yellow portion. Again, you got to put the force downward here, and you got to put the force upward here. The problem is this portion has two roller, so can it move? It cannot move as this one. Okay, the same thing. It cannot move. It has to support. So this one keep over here. Then over here, that should move for 1.0 unit. It should move down over here. And this is going to be -1.0. Since the member here is in horizontal, this one must be in horizontal. The problem is there is internal hinge over here. Okay. And this is going to be the rotating point. Okay. The portion over here, the light blue, gonna move like this one. Okay. That's going to be the inference line of the supply. If I let you guys do it, you may not do it properly. Now, that's all for the shear force. Okay. And how about next? Next, you got to draw the inference line of the moment. Okay. Now, they ask you to draw the inference line of the moment at point F. That's so complicated. Okay. Let me move you to the easier one. Let us draw the inference line of moment at point B. Okay, that's going to be easier. The moment at point B, that is going to be over here. Now, no change at point A, at point D, at point F, no change. Then internal hinge, no change. To draw the inference line of the moment at any point, you got to go to the point B. Release the resistance to the moment. So you got to put the internal hinge, okay, to release the resistance to the moment over here. Then you apply the positive moment direct over here. Okay, apply the positive moment like this one. And then like you open the door, this one will move up. Move up for what? Move up for A, B over L. Okay. Since this member didn't change at all and it cannot move, okay, let's call it as the rigid body as we previously considered it over here. It's a kind of rigid body, no movement. And then what happened, kid? This is going to be A equal to 6 meter, B equal to 6 meter. The total span going to be 12. So it's going to be 6 times 6 over 12. Cut, cut to be 2. Cut, cut to be 3. You got to have this one for 3. Okay, this one for 3. If you provide it with the same scale, it's going to be really large one. Okay, let me put it 3 equivalent to 10 millimeter. So 3 equivalent to 10 millimeter. Then you got the inference line of the moment at point B, and you should indicate this one is going to be 1.0. Okay, that's going to be the inference line of the moment at point B. Okay, now if you prefer, we have point E over here. Okay, let me put the inference line of moment at this point. Inference line of moment at point E. This is the same. The same. The same. No change. This also no change. Release the resistance to the moment at point E. Okay. Put the internal hinge and then apply positive moment, okay, positive moment like this one over here. Now, this portion have been separated into two portions, and they has this one and this one as the rotating point. This one and this one rotating point. This one must move up, okay, with the value of A, B over L. Now, what's going to be the A? This one and this one going to be A equal to 3. This one going to be B equal to 3. Total span going to be 6. It's going to be 3 times 3 divided by 6. Divide it to be 2. It's going to be 1.5. Okay, and by the scale, this is going to be only half of the centimeter. And then let me move in a bit over here. That is the rotating point. Since that is the rotating point at this point F, this portion will rotate like this one. Okay, and how about this portion? This is a rotating point, so this one will move like this one. And then this is going to be the internal hinge. This is not beautiful. Let me put it like this one, okay, better. Now, you have this one as the rotating point. You got to have this portion. So the inference line of the moment at this point E is going to be this one, okay? Inference line of M sub E. And then you have this one for 1.5. This one going to be negative 3. Why? 1.5 divided by 3. Why? Why? Divided by 6. So this is minus 3. This is going to be minus 3. The other, this is 0, this is 0, this is 0. Okay, that's going to be the moment at point E. Okay, and coming back to our drawing of the inference line diagram of the moment at point F. Okay, at point F. Let me move it to the moment at point F. Now, going back to the beam that we have for point F, we have it to be over here. Then to draw this one the same roller and internal hinge. What you should do, you got to change point F. Okay, let me put this one first to be the member. Change point F to what? This is point F. You got to change it by putting the internal hinge over the roller. Put the internal hinge over the roller. Then the yellow portion separate into two. Then you come to this point, you got to apply the same moment like this one over here. On this portion is subjected to this moment. Okay, this portion is subjected to this moment. This is connected. Okay, this one, just put the internal hinge over it. It's like this portion, like this one. You still have the support like this one. Okay, put over it. And then when it's subjected to the moment, they are constant. This one cannot move. This one and cannot move. This portion of the yellow won't move. Okay, so this portion gonna be in horizontal. Then what happened? This one going to be hanging like this one. So under this moment, it's going to rotate for 1.0 unit. And this is 6, okay? Based as upon this one, it's going to be 20 millimeter. It's going to be this one. And then you got to have, actually, it's going to be 1 per 1. This is going to be 17 millimeter. Just put it 17 millimeter to make it equal to 1.0. And this is going to be the inference line of the moment M sub F. Okay. Now, there is another one going to be the inference line of moment at point D. Point D. Let me put it over here. Inference line of the moment at point D. Let me recall you again. This is point A, the same. This is point C, internal hinge. This is point D, roller. And this is point F. You're going to know the inference line of the moment at point D. D is over here. You got to put the internal hinge on top of this one. Again, you got to put the moment up over here and up over here. Okay. What happened, kids? This portion going to have the behavior close to this one. It has the constraint of the movement by the roller over here, like this one. Okay, and also have this one for the roller. So this one won't move. Okay, since this one won't move, only this portion that has the hinge over here is should move for 1 unit. Okay, and this is 6 meter. So the movement over here will be minus 6 This one also minus 6. Now, you just connect the line between here and here. And the last one, you should get this one. Okay. That should be all I should demonstrate to you how you draw the inference line for the statically determinate beam. Okay. For this problem, if Ajahn just take this portion out, let me just take this portion out. Okay. Let me just take this portion out. The inference line is going to be something like this one. Okay. If I take the cantilever portion out, okay, just elastic. Just elastic out. You will get the same. Okay. Inference line again. And also for this one, just take this portion out. Okay. You get the same inference line again for statically determinate beam. I just take this portion out. That's going to be another examination problem. Really easy. Okay. Ajahn, can I take the heat out? No. That's going to be the subject of inference line of statically indeterminate. We got to start with next course. Any question for all this one? This is much more complicated than what we have in the PowerPoint. Now, we draw it for what? All of this is learning objective one. Okay. For the learning objective two, we draw it for loading pattern. For example, for this one, let me zoom it. Okay. They said if a uniformly distributed live load, say uniformly distributed live load, live load can move, okay, can have any length, okay, this we call LLW, okay, this one can change its length based upon the influence that we have in the inference line diagram. And then it said there is what? There is a concentrated live load. That means what? This one can move everywhere also, but it's just live load with F. Okay. It's going to be this point load F. And this one can be this kind of distributed force, and the length over here can be anything based on the influence, okay, that's shown in the pictures. Influence can be positive like this one and negative like this one. When we like to find the loading pattern, we like to find the loading pattern, we got to think about the influence. Which one gonna be larger? Like this one, there is no negative. So positive gonna be larger. This one positive, larger than negative. This is positive, larger. Okay. This picture, they are equal. They are equal influence. The positive equal to negative. This picture, negative is larger than positive. Okay, in consideration of this distributed live load, you got to think about the area. Which portion has the larger area? This larger, negative. So you got to put in the negative. This one, positive, larger. Put the uniformly distributed live load in the positive area. Again, how about this one? How about this one? This is a point load. You got to put it at the maximum. Okay, at the maximum. Okay. Ajahn, this is easy. Maximum. Okay, this is easy. This is easy for maximum. But this one is hard. There is two maximum. since they both positive you can put it any point okay you can put it any point you can put it at point C you can put it at point D going to produce the same effect again how about this one you got to decide you got to decide you got to decide to get positive here or negative here if you like to find positive here you put the plot the life load here over positive you put this one over positive if you prefer to determine the negative do the opposite okay and then there is another thing didn't mention over here it's going to be dead load okay especially the cell weight dead load also have distributed dead load distributed dead load will be all over the beam no matter the load going to put on okay it's always distributed all over the beam understand that's right and DLF is going to be the location the problem give to you most of the time I never talking about this one okay now talking about loading pattern for a subway if you just follow this one this is inference line of a subway so the area that has maximum inference gonna be this one so the load that's applied gonna be only for this portion let me put the net load first if I increase I just check this one just said this let me put this one to be the net load also okay I should start by drawing the net load okay and I said this is going to be like 50 kilonewton per meter so this is going to be 50 kilonewton per meter and then this is 150 in this area put more load over here so this is going to be add up for 150 kilonewton per meter so the total of the loading over here is going to be 200 kilonewton per meter we have the pin here we have the roller here and roller here and then this internal hinge okay and then there is the point load of 500 kilonewton so given it to be the maximum coordinate just put it over here that's going to be 500 kilonewton that's going to be for a subway okay if at that one said about the dead load just take the dead load out okay if you take the dead load out this one going to be only this portion since that is the dead load so you got to put it over there okay now let us move to the loading pattern for the maximum moment at F okay this is inference line for it okay and then based upon this beam this will be pin this be the roller this be the roller then this has only negative okay this are the negative influence and then again if we talking about the dead load must put always across the beam and this is going to be 50 kilonewton per meter and based on what we have over here put 150 over here so the total circuit going to be W equal to 150 plus 50 and then that's going to be 200 kilonewton per meter okay And then how about the pilot? The pilot gonna put at the maximum. So put it over here. You got to get this one to be 500 kilonewton. Now, when you determine the loading pattern, next, you got to compute for M sub F. Okay. M sub F have zero value across this one. So this loading produce no M sub F. Okay. Produce no M sub F. Only the area here. Gonna have distributed force. And this point load gonna have coordinate over here. So M sub F gonna be area. Area. Okay, area. Area over here time 200 kilonewton per meter. And then plus coordinate at F and then time 500 kilonewton. Okay. In the concept, if you read the textbook or if you review the PowerPoint, okay, uniformly distributed load time the area and point load time the coordinate. So basis upon this one is going to be 200 kilonewton per meter times the area here, one half. The length here is 6 meter times 6. And this one is minus 6 times minus 6. You got to use the negative also. Okay? And then you got to plus. The coordinate here is minus 6, so it's going to be minus 6 times 500 kilonewton. And then you should get this one. Cut. This is 3 minus 18, minus 18 times 200. Minus 18 times 200. What do you get? Negative. Okay. What do you get? 18 times 2,600. This one times cut 18 times 2,36, right? So it's gonna be minus 3,600, right? And how about this one? This one is gonna be minus 3,000. So the total is gonna be minus 6,600 kilonewton meter. Okay, you got to decide this point with this large moment. If you want include the dead load, okay, I have the presentation before this one. If you want include the dead load, this one just be 150. Okay, this one still be the same. Okay, the moment just reduced to minus 5,700. How about A sub Y? Let us move to over here. Over here. For the A sub Y. Again, the portion over here produces zero influence. So the load putting over here won't produce A sub Y at all. And then A sub Y is going to be, again, the area over here times 200. I should get 200 kilonewton per meter. And then Ajahn got to determine the area. This is going to be one half times one. The distance here going to be 12. Okay, and this is cut to be 6. Then, for the point load, do the same thing. Plus, this is 1. This is 500. 1, Point O coordinate times 500, then you should get 6 times 200. That's going to be 1,200, and then plus 500, you get positive 1,700 kilonewton. Okay, for this calculation. That is the finish of problem 1 point, or problem 3 in our second midterm examination. Okay, and if you prefer, you may move a bit to our lecture. Okay, in our lecture, we have Musler-Wessler principle. The wording is so long, no one can remember it. Don't need to. Okay. The main thing, the use of Musler-Wessler principle, the beam is assumed to be rigid beam. Okay, so the inference line of this rigid beam gonna be straight line, no curve at all. Okay, due to this one. And then we have learned about it. Like to draw the inference line of the reaction A sub Y. Check the pin, okay, to be the roller. Why? To remove the capacity to resist A sub Y out. And then we like to move it by putting it up for 1.0 unit. And then we have the rigid movement. That's inference line of A sub 1. Okay? And inference line of B sub C, change it to the roller guide. And then you got to put the positive shear applying it on the left downward, on the right upward. And then you got the shear copy. And I should say something about this one. The line over here and over here must be in parallel. The combination of movement here must be 1.0. And then if you get this one to be A, this one to be B, this one A divided by L, when L is going to be the length between these two support, and over here gonna be positive B over L. If you know this one minus A over L, you know this is A. This is going to be positive A over L. Okay, use the proportion. Then for the moment, you release the moment by putting the internal hinge over here. Okay, and apply the positive bending moment in order to move the rigid beam. Okay, you move it up by this one. The rigid body movement occur. Over here to here is going to be AB over L, as we discussed from the previous slide, and total over here going to be 1.0. And then we have three examples over here, and over here. I did assign you guys for the sales study, okay? I have that one for your video clips already. Now, what could we use? We're going to use the inference line of the beam to determine the maximum value. Okay, to get this one, you got to find the loading pattern on the beam. That's going to produce it. And then following the concept as previously discussed for the point load, you got to multiply the force by the coordinate to get A sub Y. Just multiply to get R sub A. Just multiply the coordinate point C with the magnitude of the force. To get the R sub B, just multiply point 4. Okay, then you will get this one to be 6 kilonewton. This one to be 4 kilonewton. Then if you do the summation of F sub Y, it's gonna be 0. Proof. Okay. And also for this one, for the shear, just take 5.6 times 10. the tear gonna be 6 kilonewton. Okay, and then you can prove it for the moment also. Now you can have it to be 2.4 × 10^24 kilonewton, and you take this free body diagram, and then you take the R sub A from the previous one. You may prove the moment to be 24 as shown over here, kilonewton meter, and the shear force is gonna be 6 kilonewton. And then for the uniformly distributed load, if you prefer to put the uniformly distributed here, you got to determine the area over here. Okay, the area gonna have 10 kilonewton per meter. What's going to be the area over here? It's gonna be 1/2 of what? Of 0.6 of what? 12 meter. Okay, just put it together, you get R sub A. Okay, and then this R sub A is going to be 36 over here. And if you prefer to determine R sub B, now you put 10 kilonewton per meter with this purple area, you get the load to be what? 34. If you put it 84 over here, summation of F sub Y will be 36 plus 84 minus 100. That's going to be 0. So, proof, okay? Proof of the uniformly distributed load. Time what? Time the magnitude of the what's so called LLW. Now, for this one, you can prove for the shear and you can prove for the moment also. Since we have the force over here to be 36 kilonewton. Okay, so based on the free body diagram, over this portion, you get the same result. So this proof, okay? And then there are more examples. Okay, I like you guys to do so. By what? When you get the reaction, okay? This one you get from the previous slide over, here. 36 and 84. This is 36, and then this is 84, subjected to the distributed force. Now, use the same concept. You can draw the shear diagram, you can draw the movement diagram, and then you also can plot the elastic curve. This one for the elastic curve. Okay, then. There are valid examples. Let you guys go through it by yourself. Okay, you can do it for sure. Again, point load time coordinate. Okay, and then uniformly distributed load time the area. LLF time coordinate. Okay, LLW time the area. How about DLW times the area also, okay? If we like to have the dead load, you got to put the dead load on top of this one. Just put it on top. And the dead load, W, gonna be along the length of the beam, okay? If I put this one to be 1 kilonewton per meter, then the magnitude of this one will change, okay? Change by what? Change by this one, change to 3. And this one gonna get a bit larger. Change from 2 kilonewton plus this one kilonewton per meter. This is 3 kilonewton per meter. If you consider the cell weight, the maximum moment gonna get larger. Okay? And then there are one more example like this one. You guys can do it. This one is good because combine everything. This one, uniformly distributed dead load. This is gonna be concentrated lifelong. This one, uniformly distributed lifelong. Okay, just follow this one, you can get the result, and then you can use it to plot the เชียร์แดกแดงแอดโมเมนต์แดกเลยโอเคแอนนะ another one we can follow what we have a lot in the PowerPoint let me finish our third problem over here and I should let you guys have 5 minute break and then I will go to the last problem of our midterm examination that's going to be what that's going to be the absolute maximum shear and absolute maximum moment I won't have it over here how come Oh, noted. Anyway, we just finished this one. Okay, this one. Okay, this one, we just finished this one. And then this is going to be our fourth problem in the second midterm examination to determine absolute maximum shear and absolute maximum moment. So take 5 minutes. Okay, we will come back at 4. So will you finish all the things for second midterm also? My last task for the week after the Gang Festival. I'm not sure my dad has something good to talk. He will have a great on the Monday. And it's up to you and it's on Monday or if it's on Thursday. Personally, but it's going to be the meeting. I provide you the whole year's midterm examination for you guys for the year. So, we have to do the movie with the characters you want. I didn't do it well. How can I call them with the movie back? You can't have the movie with the whole one today, right? How about the movie back? This evening, it should be okay with that, right? Okay, class, let me start the second part of my lecture on chapter 6, inference line of statically determined structure. As I mentioned before, we take away, we're going to come to our third learning objective, and then this is going to be our problem number 4 in our second midterm examination. And the problem is, in reality, what we have discussed from the previous one, we're talking about a beam that's statically determined. Beam, it can be this kind of beam, or it's also can be this kind of beam also. They are statically determined. Okay. And what we have is, we know the inference line diagram topic suggests for this one is going to be the inference line of the reaction of R sub A Y. Okay, it's going to be the straight line. And then when we use this, we just trying to put the load that's going to provide the largest effect on the structure. And that's going to involve with what? With live load W, live load F, okay, and maybe the dead load W. Now, in reality, vehicle may have various kind of loading on the wheel pocket, such as this 10-wheeler. This 10-wheeler didn't provide only the side load. Okay, it will provide a series of loading. I should say it's going to be series of loading. That's why we got to determine the absolute maximum shear and absolute maximum moment. Okay, actually, in reality, it's going to be the combination when we decide it of this learning concept and the previous learning concept. When you prefer to, the life load due to the vehicle, okay, have various types. Maybe for this one single unit, you have only two. For this one, you have three, you have four, okay. For the semi-trailer, you may have five. For the full trailer, you have one, two, three, four, five, six, okay. In our discussion, the loading from the vehicle, we're going to consider only two-fold of the loading in the series. I won't take you to over here or take you to over here. That's maybe a bit too much. So we're going to focus on kind of single unit load. And I have various video clips talking about this type of loading. In Thailand, we have this one, okay, and then for the maximum influence first. Before we talking about the absolute maximum, we got to talking about maximum influence due to theory of pilot first. Okay, theory of pilot is usually due to the accelerator of the vehicle, as I just showed you guys from the previous two slides. This accelerator may lead to different loading pattern, and one of them will cause the maximum influence. We can find it by using the trial and error method, such as talking about the shear. If you guys like to analyze and design this welding joint, let me call this, it's going to be the welding joints of a steel girder of a bridge, okay? And then this one is going to subject this series of loading. Now, from the previous learning objective, you guys can draw the inference line of the shear force as these welding joints. By what? Release the resistance of the shear force over here, putting the shear downwards on the left and upward to the right. And then you have this one to be A, this one to be B. You have this one to be negative 3 over 12. And then you will get this one to be negative 1 over 4. This is going to be negative 0.25. On this portion, you will get what? B over L. That's going to be 9 over 12. That's going to be 3 over 4. That's going to be positive 0.75. From the previous concept of problem 3 in the examination, you got to put the live load W, live load F, dead load W onto this B. But this one won't. This one, you're going to move the vehicle over here and trying to determine the shear force due to loading pattern. Then you move it over here. You trying to determine the second loading pattern. And the third, you move it over here and determine the third. Okay, and compare them. You got to get the maximum influence. Now, case number one. 5 kilonewton times 0.75. 50 kilonewton times 0.667. And then, how I get this 0.667 coming to this one? Use the similar triangle. This is going to be 0.75. And this is going to be what? 9 meter, so it's going to be 0.75 divided by 9, and then this is going to be y1 going to be what divided by this length is going to be what 8 meter, so y1 divided by 8, y1 is going to be 0.75 times 8 over 9. You get this one. Okay, the same thing. How about 30 kilonewton? 30 kilonewton will time 0.5. Okay, again, this is Y2. You have 7.75 divided by 9, and you have Y2 divided by this is what? This is what? This is 6. So Y2 is 0.75 times 6 over 9, you get 0.5. Then the first one, 52.1 kilonewton. Now, move it to the second one, do the same thing. However, this time, 5 gonna time the negative. 50 gonna time 0.75, 30 gonna time 0.583. You get the second one. This one is larger, okay? Coming to the third one, for sure, is going to get smaller. Compare all of them, you get second case to provide you the maximum shear force. Okay, and then you can move to maximum moment. Maximum moment, you do the same thing. Change this one toward internal hinge. Apply the positive moment. This one going to move, and it's moved by what? A B over L. It's gonna be 3 times 9 over 12. This is gonna be 9 over 4. This is gonna be positive 2.25. Do the same thing. Move the load over here. Compute for the case one. Move the load over here. Compute for the case two. Move the load over here. Compute for the case three. You can get all the result from this one. Case one, 5 times this one. 50, you get this one for 2.0. And 30 times this one, 156.25. Second case, you also can get it to be 172.5. And the third case, you get it to be 105. Okay. Now, you get all the result of the maximum momentum. But the maximum that cause the most influence gonna be the second one for this one. Okay. Is that going to be the absolute maximum shear and absolute maximum moment? No. This is for a specific point when you like to decide for what? Welding joints. Okay. What's going to cause the maximum? As you know, for a beam, when it's subjected to this kind of loading, the maximum moment will occur at what? At this mid-span location. But this one is a bit harder. It's not exactly occur at the mid-span due to the ceiling of loading. Okay? But for this one, it's gonna be higher than the moment occur over here for sure. Okay? How about the maximum shear? The absolute maximum shear supposed to occur on the support. Okay, the reaction and the shear are going to be the same. So now, for the typical maximum influence for a given point, use this concept. But for the absolute maximum, you got to use the another one. Okay. Come to the absolute maximum shear and absolute maximum moment. Let us consider the candle beam. If you prefer to determine the shear force at the support of this one, put it to be the roller guide. And this one gonna move down, and this one gonna move up. This one cannot move up because it's easily rigid joint. So for this one to move down, it's going to be a constant of minus one, since it's going to be parallel to its previous one. Then, based upon this one, no matter you put the load, it's going to provide the same effect of absolute maximum shear of the beam. In conclusion, candle beam, you can put any kind of live loading pattern that's going to produce the same absolute maximum shear on the beam. But for this one, okay, the absolute maximum again will occur at the support. It may be occur at B or it may be occur at B. Okay, and then this is easy. Just use the concept of the first learning objective, draw the inference line of the reaction. Then use the previous concept, move the load, okay, to any location if you prefer. Okay, you may just compare them and then you will get the result. Now, let me take you back to another example that we have over here. On the fourth problem, again, we will provide you this kind of wedding that is 15 meter long simply supported beam. And then there is no figure of the beam. It is your duty, okay, to draw the beam by yourself. Let me put it for scale 15 meter. 15 meter. What do I have for this one? I have the area over here about 8 centimeter. Let's divide it by 2. That's going to be 75 millimeter. Okay. By using this one, I'm going to get my beam to be something like this one. Now, I have a simply supported beam with the length of 15 meter. This subjected to series of loading. It may be subjected to a series of 10 welder. And then they ask us to determine the absolute maximum shear force. Huh, that's going to be easy. By using the same concept of what? The maximum, let's put it to be 4.8, okay? Absolute maximum shear force on a simple beam. You may call it a simple beam, okay? Equivalent to absolute maximum reaction at the beam support. That means it can occur at any point A or any point B. Don't worry. Okay, don't worry. Okay, this may be support A or B for this one. This is 15 meter. Okay, so we got to what does we need to draw inference line of A sub Y or B sub Y. Let me just draw the inference line of this A sub Y. I put this one over here. I just take this one the same. Change this one to the roller. I can move this one for 10 millimeter compared to be 1.0. This is going to be the rotating point. You have this one to be the inference line. Now, we got to do what? Then we tile and error, okay, to determine, what so called the V absolute maximum. Okay, now we have this one. We got to put this one in different cases. Let me put this one, the first one, loading pattern, and it should be at least 3. Second one, because it's absolute maximum, you got to show it by at least 3 of them. Ah, okay, we have this 3 beam, pin and roller. Then what's going to be the first one? Thinking about the loading over here, maximum is 125, and we are looking for the maximum effect occur over here. So the first one, I should put this one to be 125 kilonewton. And then 2 meter, okay, 2 meter is going to be 2 times 75 divided by 15. Okay, that's cut. It's going to be about 1 centimeter. This is going to be on scale. Okay, on scale. This is going to be 100 kilonewton. And this one going to be 15 millimeter. So it should be this one 50 kilonewton. Then this for case one. Case one. Okay. We need to determine this one time one. This one gonna time coordinate over here. And this one gonna time the coordinate over here. Now, what you get, this one is 2 meter. This one is 3 meter. And this one gonna be 10 meter. Then we have V sub C one. That's going to be 125 times one plus 100 times the ratio. Okay, this is 1/15. This is going to be y1/13. So it's going to be 13 divided by 15. 13 is a distance between its load. Measure up to here. The ratio always like this. Okay. And then plus 50 times this one y2. This one divided by 15. y2 divided by 10. So it's going to be 10 divided by 15. You get to 45 kilonewton. Okay. And then the vehicle can move this way and it's moved in the opposite direction. Now let's it's moved to opposite direction. This is gonna be 50. And this one is gonna be 100. Okay, and one more centimeter over here. And this one gonna be 125. Okay, so case two, okay, V sub C two, you get 50, and then time over here of one, okay, and this is 100 kilonewton, hot kit up over here, and this is 3 meter, 2 meter, 10 meter, plus the second one, 100. 100 times what? 100 times this one, y3. 1 divided by 15, y3 divided by from here to here, 12 meter, 12 divided by 15. And the last one you have plus 1, 25 times again, y2. You know it to be 10 over 15. You get the second one to be 213.33 kilonewton. And then they're supposed to have another one. Okay, have another one. Let's take this one back. Okay, you may get this one to be 100 kilonewton. And take this one to be 2 meter and 125 kilonewton. This is going to be 2 meter. Now, the third one, case number three, V sub C three. You get 100 times one, 100 times one. And then you get 125 times y1 plus 125, 13 over 15. You get this one to be 208.33 kilonewton. Okay. Ajahn may have other pattern up to you, but you got to show me at least three to obtain the exact result. So we have V absolute maximum at A equal to 245 kilonewton. That's going to be the first portion of your fourth question. Okay. Now, you got answer over here to 45 kilonewton.
the procedure of the analysis. First, we got to draw the inference line diagram of the reaction. For example, from the previous one, let us determine the what the inference line of the A supply. As you may can, you can see from this one, you draw, we draw this, and then the second one, we put the given vehicle load on the inference line diagram, and then we find the coordinate of the inference line, and then we determine the shear force in each cases. The previous one we did for four cases, okay, and finally compare the obtained result, and then you will find the absolute maximum shear force. Okay, come to our problem now. Our problem is 18 meter beam. Okay, the beam A beam have L equal to 18 meter, and we have this truck. Okay, it have a 3-point load, and then the L is 18 meter. D1 over here is going to be 2 meter, and this one going to be 6 meter. Now, you just draw the inference line diagram of A sub Y. Just release this resistance to A sub Y. You get the roller, okay, in the X direction. This one do the same. When you move this one unit, you got this one as the inference line diagram of A sub Y. And then you put the vehicle load on the diagram. And then we have this one. This one, you move this one may produce the largest one. And this one is what? The truck is 8 meter. So this one will what? Will time 20 kilonewton. Will time the coordinate of this is one. This time will time the coordinate here. And then you can determine the coordinate y1 over what? Over this horizontal distance, that is going to be 18 minus 2, that is going to be 16 equal to 1 divided by 18. So this is going to be 16 by 18. Okay, and then the third one is going to be here. Okay, this is going to be the length of 10 meters. And then this is going to be y2 divided by 10 equal to 1 divided by 18. So this one going to be 10 divided by 18. And then you find the coordinate of this. Okay, they'll have this one for 16 by 18 as we determine here. And this one, we have this one for 10 over 18, that is 5 over 9. And then you put together, you get the first one for 169.44 kilonewton. Okay, and then we move this one to the second case. Just check it now. 25 kilonewton out of the inference line diagram. This will produce zero effect for A supply. And then we put 100 times 1 here. And then we put another 100 times this one. This one is what? This one is y3 over this distance. This is 6 meter. That is going to be 12. And then it's 1 over 18. So this is going to be 12 over 18. Just put it like this. 12 over 18 is 6 over 9 is 2 over 3. Just put everything. So you get the second one for 166.67, compared to the second case, okay? And not enough. Now, we dive the truck to Bangkok, okay? And we still have this step. This first step, 199.44, and the second step, 166.67. And now, we come to Kola. By this way, we do the computation again. You got this one for 122.22. And then you come to Kola by this kind of loading pattern. This is a loading pattern number 4. Okay, and now you get 100 times 1. And then you get 100 times this coordinate. You get 25 times this coordinate. And you can determine the coordinate by similar triangle. You get this one for the maximum on these 4 cases. And this called the absolute maximum shear force occur at the pin support A, which is 180.59. And mainly, this is the examination that we supposed to be able to, because when you determine this, it's not just the shear force that you're going to use to decide the beam. And this shear is equivalent to the reaction air supply. So you can use to decide maybe the pier that support the support the pin support A, or you may decide the foundation foundation of this beam. Okay, it's not just the shear force decide the beam, but for the reaction you can use to decide the pier, which is the short column that support the pin support, and also you can determine the foundation. Okay, next we're going to determine the absolute maximum bending moment. Can you draw the inference line of moment at this support? Okay, you can do it, right? Just check this one into the internal hinge, and then you apply the moment here. Okay, and another one is here. The moment here produce nothing because it's at the fixed support. Okay, it's at to the fixed support, produce nothing. So this one gonna rotate the beam by relative angle of 1 unit. And then if this one is 10 meter, then the coordinate here gonna be minus 10, because this is 1.0 relative angle. Now, this thing, you got to do the same thing. You got to what? You got to find the loading pattern that's going to produce the, for example, this one, M1. This M1 is going to be 25 times 1 plus what? Plus this one. This is going to be this one. This is going to be 100 times the coordinate here. Since this one is 2 meter, if you remember them, this is going to be minus 8. It's just to be, this is minus 1. This is going to be minus 8. And this also project into this, and then you got to have this one plus 100, and this one gonna be minus what? This is gonna be also 8 meter. This is gonna be minus 2, and then you put them together. That is going to be minus 800, minus 1. Minus 800, minus 200. That is going to be minus 1,000. That is going to be minus 1,000 and 25 kilonewton, right? That is meter, going to be the moment, kilonewton, meter. That is going to be 800. That is going to be 200. That is going to be 25. Okay, you can find it here, do the computation. Oh, sorry, that's it. Oh, this is not 1.0, this is 10, sorry. This is gonna be 1,250. Okay, this is coordinate of 10. How come I put this one to minus 1? Okay, for this one. And then you move it again in this way. By this one, you get the second thing. You get the M2, and then your M2 is going to be this one going to be 100 and then time this one time minus 10. It won't make any sense in this case. And then you get what? You get this thing, this thing, this thing. Sorry, this thing, this thing. Is what is 100? That is 100. And then time this one, this is what? This is 6 meter. This is going to be minus 4. And then plus the last one is going to be 100. Now, this one, no, 25, sorry, 100, 25. You got to plus 25. And then time this one for 0.2, minus 2. And then you do the computation for these two. You get it for, this is going to be minus 100. But 1,000, this is minus 400, okay? And this is minus 50. This is going to be minus 1,450 kilonewton meter, which is larger than the previous one. So by doing this, you get the absolute maximum bending moment for the second case for this one, okay? Now, you have learned to compute the absolute maximum shear for the pan river beam and also for the simply supported beam. And now you have learned how to compute absolute maximum bending moment for what? For the pan river beam. And the concept for what? From the tile and Euler method. Okay, you got to practice about this. And then the last one, for the simply supported beam, the way to compute the maximum moment, absolute maximum moment for the simply supported beam requires us to compute in many steps. Since the absolute maximum moment is not exactly occur at the midspan of the beam, is most of the time is what occur here, but it will occur in the area near it. Okay, the first one, when you find the F sub R, okay, and then you can determine the position of the resultant loading. F sub I is easy. F sub I equal to F1 plus F2 plus F3. Okay, but the X bar, that is the knowledge that you have to find the centroid of the set of the forces. Okay, from the engine static. By doing this, you will see X bar equal to summation of F sub I times X sub I curve divided by F sub R. Okay, can you remember this? If not, I will clarify this later. Okay, this is going to be equal to the summation of this first force time is centroid is test distance plus F2. This one gonna be F1 time X1 curve, the centroid of F1 from the reference axis, plus F2 time X2 curve, plus F3 time X3 curve. This is going to be this value of the summation. And then what? Is the maximum is going to be somewhere you going to put it into somewhere above here. It's maybe occur under the load here, or it's maybe under the load here. Okay, but it won't be at the midspan of this. So we got to follow the procedure of analysis carefully again. For this absolute maximum moment of simply supported, you got to follow the procedure of analysis closely. And then you got the F sub R time X bar equal to summation of the moment. And then you get F sub R. First, we must divide the F sub R into half, okay? You put it, and then you do the computation, okay? You find this one, for what? For the A supply. And this one will produce the maximum over here. Okay, and then you need to be in the M of this case under the load of F2. And you do the same thing, just put another half onto, there is another half, the left of it, okay, onto the middle of it. And do the same thing. This time, the maximum will occur here. Okay, I will show you later. And there is a proof in this one. You can determine it. Okay, and then you get the F3. And then you compute what? You compute the M3 from the free body diagram of this portion. That means you're going to find V supply. And then you get the M3. Okay, but this time you got to compare the M2 and M3 and then from the step 6 previously and this step 10 and then you get the absolute maximum here. Okay, anyway, let me show the example. For the proof of X equal to X time divided by 2, I like you guys to go to it by yourself. Okay, and then we have the proof here, the same thing, by the F sub R first, and by the position of X bar, X R, okay, and then put half of it into put a portion of it into the middle, this span of the beam. This is going to be the midspan of the beam. And then you can compute, and then you can show that this one going to produce this one, X equal to X bar over 2. And then in conclusion, the absolute maximum moment in the simple support beam maybe occur under the maximum load, maybe occur under this load. When the midspan is half the distance, okay, half the distance, half distance of maximum load, and the maximum F sub R, if this one is met, okay, this is F sub R, just put the distance half of it at the midspan of the beam and compute the moment here, okay? And this is not exact one. You also need to find another half of this and put another half of it at the midspan. And this time compute another one and compare it. It's better to show you by using the example. And then the first one, F sub I is easy to determine, and X bar is depend on what you like to use. And most of the time, Ajahn will give you the reference line for you guys to determine the X bar for this type of cases. Just go back to the engineering schematic. That is going to be chapter, if I correct, it's going to be chapter 10, okay, chapter 9, to determine the centroid of a set of a force, okay? And if you determine X bar wrong, everything that's to do the computation will get wrong, okay? And then coming to the procedure, there is a lot of procedure. It's better to do the same thing. It's very hard to just take a look at this total of 11 steps and understand it. It's better than put your hand on the problem and then you can do it easily. And this way, let me show you guys some extra example, because for this kind of example, we can go to this kind of example quickly to get understanding in the big picture of this problem, okay, before I show you some extra example. Let's see, we have 3 loading points for this truck, okay. The first step, just find the F sub R. We need to be the F sub R of this one. F sub R is going to be 100 plus 35 to 225. And then to determine the X bar, the centroid, is depend on the reference point you are using. If I set you guys to determine the X bar from this second load. Okay, as the reference line, now you can use the what's so called the equivalent of moment. The problem of equivalent of moment, you also have studied in the kinesthetic. What it is the moment due to the F sub R times X bar is going to be equivalent. That's different from equal, okay? Because it's going to think equivalent is going to be the thing is going to be rotated in the same direction, not equilibrium. Equilibrium is going to be in the different direction and equal. This equivalent is the same direction and equal. So you have this one for 225 and rotate this way. That's here, 225 X bar. And then by using this different, the 100 gonna have zero, okay? Another one, this is going to rotate in the same direction due to the concept of equivalent moment. You got this one plus. However, this one is in the opposite direction. You got this one for the negative. So putting this one for 2.224, that means you're going to divide this 2.224 into half. Just divide this one into half. That is going to be 1.222 meter. Just put this back dash line into this peak dash line. And then you do the setting up like this. So this one is what? This one is going to be 1.222. This one is going to be 1.222 meter. And then by doing this, what you have is this one. This one is going to be 9 meter. This one 9 minus 1.222. And this one also is going to be, this is 1.29 minus 1.222. Okay. And what you have is you can find what? This one, the maximum moment will occur under the load here. Okay. That's nearest to the midspan of this beam. Now we put this one and then we going to determine this A sub Y by summation of the moment about B. And the concept is, depending on you, you may do the summation of the moment, okay, of the moment about B. And then you may have this one for what? A sub Y times 18 meter, okay? That is going to be in this positive direction, and 225 is going to be rotated in different one, and 225 gonna rotate by this 7.778, and then you get this one for A sub one. Okay, and another way, if you prefer a tough way, you may do the summation of the moment about B is equal to zero, and then you get the same 18 A sub Y equal to this one. You may find this one, times this distance, okay? And then this one times this distance, and then this one times this distance, okay? And then you get the same A sub Y, but the computation going to be very tough, okay? Okay, by doing this, you may see, you may get 100 is going to have this distance, okay? And this distance is what? Just say, do check for this one first. This one is 100 times this distance. This distance is what? This is going to be 9 meter. And then you're going to plus this one for 1.222. This is going to be 10.222. So this is 10.222. And then this one to this one is 6 meter. The distance here is going to be 10.222 minus 6. That is going to be 4.222. Okay. Okay. And how about this one? This one is 10.222. This is going to be this is correct, right? Yes, this is correct. This is 9. 9 plus this one. And then you put two more. You going to plus 25 is 100 times the distance here. That is going to be 12.222. You may try to put them together. You supposed to get the same A sub Y. What I mean is you can determine A sub Y by the easier way. The easier way. If you use the easy way, easy way. You just put the F sub R, okay, times the distance. If you don't do, you like to have the tough way, just put this or of this force into the moment, okay, and you could get the same answer. And anyway, I recommend you guys to do this if you prefer. And then what? You got to draw the free body diagram of this portion. And again, this portion is 9 minus this distance, 1.222 meter. You get the free body diagram. This one was 7.778. And do the summation of the moment. Here, you get this one for 706.22. Okay, the M sub 2. And then this one going to rotate in the same direction. So 25 plus 2 is positive, but this one going to produce the negative moment. And then, not enough, there is another way. We use this X bar already, right? This is the X bar. So we have another one. The total of this is going to be 6 minus X bar, and then 6 minus X bar is 3.556. Now, we like to find this distance is going to be 3.556 divided by 2. And now, the maximum moment for this case will occur under the load. That's closest to the midspan of the beam, which is going to be this load. That means we are going to determine the B sub Y. Okay, based on this, this is going to be 1.778. Okay, and then to determine the B sub Y, we're going to take the moment about A, summation of the moment about A, and then we have B sub Y times 18 meter. Rotates like this is positive, and 225 gonna have this distance, and this is going to be what? This is 9 meter, and minus this is going to be 9 meter minus 1.78 is going to be 7.222. You got B sub Y of 90.275. You need to be in the moment in this case as M3. Do it. You get it for 652. This is going to be the smaller number compared from the previous one. So the absolute maximum moment for this case is 702.22 kilonewton meter. Okay, and I like to show you how to compute this basis on our manual calculation.
Then they ask you the next one, the absolute maximum bending moment. Okay, again, absolute maximum bending moment supposed to be occur in this middle area, but we didn't have just point load, we have series of loading. Okay, there are methods to determine the absolute maximum bending moment without going to the PowerPoint. To determine the absolute maximum bending moment, we have the following procedure. Okay. The first one, the concept is, if there is the point load over here, if there is point load over here, the point load will be at the middle of this beam, right? Right? But we have series of loading. It's not just a point load. How are we going to put first one at this mid-span and then move to the second one at the mid-span and then put the third one at the mid-span? That's going to be produce the maximum absolute moment? No, it's what there are theory in the textbook from Professor Hibbler. Okay, you got to find the pattern. The load gonna put onto the beam. Okay, it's not at the middle. It's gonna be close to the middle. You may go on the textbook and see the proof. But the procedure gonna be something like this one. First, you got to determine F sub R. Okay, that is going to be the representative of the series of the load. And this is sub R supposed to put close to the middle. Okay. And then you got to determine the distance X bar. X bar is the location of the F sub R. Now, let Ajahn put this one over here and put this one as the reference line. And then Ajahn should say, you should have F sub R due to the combination of this one. Since this is large, I think this is going to be our F sub R. And then I should say, this is going to be our X bar. Ah, that's graphically gonna represent it. So F sub R is going to be 125 plus 100 plus 50. You will get this one to be 275 kilonewton. This is 275 kilonewton. And we should put this one at this location, right? Yes, but not exactly right. That is the way to do so later. Later, just find X bar first. Just determine X bar first, okay? Let me put this one to be the reference line, and we know this one, F sub R times X bar will be equivalent to, I said, not equal, it said equivalent, okay? This is going to be concept of equivalent moment. Okay, the moment gonna rotate in the same direction. We just consider the magnitude copy. F sub R time R rotate in this direction and equivalent to 100 times 2 plus 50 times 5. Then you have X bar. You have X bar equal to this one to be what? 200 plus this one, 250 divided by 275, and then you get it to be 1.636 meter. Okay. Now, what is going to be the loading pattern? Take the same thing, okay? Measure this one for 75 millimeter. We have the loading pattern number one, okay? Take this one by half, okay? It's gonna be 3.75. This is gonna be about this point. And separate this one into two portions. Take this one at the middle. This is gonna be 7.5 meter. Okay. Consider case one. Okay. The case one said, after you get this one, you have the line F sub R over here. X sub R over here, okay, and then you also have this one, okay. The location for the first case, we got to separate this one into half. Okay, divide the distance between F sub R and internal force to be half. Then you will have the distance here and distance here to be 2 minus 1.636 and divided by 2. Okay, you got to get this half of the distance, and that is going to be equal to 0.182 meter. Now, case number one. Take this dashed line over here. Okay, and then put this one, nah, 100 kilonewton to the line. This is the real force, 125 kilonewton. Then put this peak F sub R over here. Put the peak F sub R over here, not the real one. This is going to be 275, and the distance between it is going to be what we discussed, 0.182. Then you measure from here to here for 3 meter. That's going to be 1.5 meter. This is going to be your 50 kilonewton, and this is going to be 3 meter. And then from this one, 125, dock it back 2 meter, 10. So you get this one. Oh, sorry, this is 100. Okay, this is going to be 125 kilonewton. Now, the beam, okay, subjected to the loading case number one, you got to determine the reaction. Okay, it's going to be this one for B sub Y and this one for A sub Y. The principle said the maximum moment won't occur at the middle, but it will occur at the loading that's closest to this one. So it should be occur over here, only for under 100 kilonewton force, and this one to be 50 kilonewton, and this one going to be our force of B sub Y. Okay, and then this is going to be 3 meter. Now, what you have over here, from here to here is 7.5. So from here to here is going to be 7.5 minus 0.182. Okay, so you should get this one to be 7.318 meter. Now this is 0.31. We got to determine V sub Y first before we can determine M over here. Summation of the moment about A equal to 0, V sub Y times 15. V sub Y times 15. Okay. For this one, you don't need to take the load here. Just take this one. Okay. Representative of it going to be 275. And the distance from here to here is going to be equal to this distance times 7.318. You're going to get B sub Y to be 134.163 kilonewton. 134.163 kilonewton. Then summation of the moment over here. Okay, that is positive. This one, okay, positive. M over here will equal to 133.163 times 7.318 and minus 50 times 3. Okay, you will get this M to be this one, M. Okay, equal to this one. Okay, negative this one. M is going to be at 31.9 kilonewton meter. This is going to be your case number one. Now, change it to case number two. Okay, in case number two, you do the same thing. Draw the same beam. We have what? We have the middle over here. Okay, over here. Just take this one as the middle. Now, what to do, kid? You got to separate this second portion over here. Okay, this is going to be the distance x bar over 2. Okay, and that's going to be 0.818 meter. You take 0.818 meter over here. Okay, and then you have this one for 125 kilonewton, and you have this one to be the F sub R to 75 kilonewton. And then next over here for one, this one, you get this one to be 100 kilonewton, and this one going to be 50 kilonewton. Now the load that process to the middle is going to be this one. You got to consider this portion, and this is going to be 125 kilonewton. And over here you have A sub Y. Over here you have A sub Y. Now the distance from here to here is what? It's going to be the total of 7.5 and minus the distance over here, 0.818. So this is 7.5 and then minus 0.818. You get this one to be 6.685 meter. 6.685 meter. Now, following this one, you got to determine A sub Y. Summation at point B equal to 0. You have this rotation A sub Y times the total of 15 equal to this one, 175. And 175 gonna have this distance, the same as this one, 6.685 meter equal to 75 times 6.685. You get A sub Y to be 122.50 kilonewton. This is 122.5 kilonewton. Then this is going to be the next M. Let's call this one M2. This is M1. Summation of the moment equal to 0. M2 is 122.5 times 6.685. 6.825. 85, right? S2, sorry, W2, this is 2. At 2, and then you should get this one to be 818.5 kilonewton meter. And then following these two comparison, you have M absolute max, okay, to be 831.9 kilonewton meter. Just follow this procedure without going to the theory. is always the step you got to you to determine the absolute maximum moment. Okay, and I should finish my lecture over here and hope you are ready for your second midterm examination. For the theory behind this one, you can learn it from my PowerPoint. Okay, just check this one and check this one. You may slow down the video clip and try to understand it. But the backup theory have shown in the textbook. Okay, that's all for today. Any question? No question. Thank you.
Let's ask, consider this problem, the easiest one, and we move later to the three loading point. And for the loading point, I will give you as the example, as the homework to go back and study by yourself. I like to make some adjustment to this. This is changing for 2 meters, okay? Now, we're going to determine two things, absolute maximum shear, and we are going to determine the absolute maximum moment for this girder. The loading is easy, just 2 point loading. Anyway, coming into the maximum shear force, we are going to draw the inference line. Okay, the first one, when we like to determine this, we just draw the inference line. You just pick up, okay, the one thing, okay, A sub y or B sub y, whatsoever you like, is supposed to provide the absolute maximum shear as your vision, okay? So the first one, find the absolute maximum, you may put it in short like this, maximum shear and then force. Okay, so that one, just draw the inference line of this beam. Okay, first one, draw the inference line of A sub y by using the Bermuller Bessler principle. Okay, just use this one principle. By what? Just keep this one as before. You release the A sub y, show your understanding. Put the A sub y here and move this one for 1 unit, and then you get this one, okay, or 1 point. This is the rotating point. You get it as the inference line of A sub y. And then the loading pattern, you need to start by drawing the beam. Let me put it in back. Okay, the beam in back. The first case, you may just put the load like this into the beam. So the first one, you just put this 10.8. Just put this 10.8 into this beam. And then this is 4.5 meter. And then this 4.5 meter, 4.5 meter by 50 millimeter. And then you got this one 2 meter, 2 times 50 divided by 2.5. Okay, and then you get the second position of what? 100 divided by 4.5. 222, that is about 22 millimeter. Just put this one into the position. You're supposed to use the scale. Okay, 22 is going to be here. That is going to be 8.1 kilonewton. That is the pattern number one. And then you also have the second pattern. The 2 point load going to be very easy. Just put like this. And then what you have is going to be switching this is going to be 8.1 kilonewton, and this one is going to be 10.8 kilonewton. This is going to be the second case. So the second, determine the A sub Y for each case. Okay, and then we have the first one, A sub Y one equal to this one will be 10.8, and then 10.8 times what? Times this one, times 1 plus 8.1 times this one. This is going to be 2 meter. This is going to be 2.5 meter. So you have this y over 2.5 equal to 1. Equal to 1 over 4.5. So y is going to be 2.5 divided by 4.5. If you push it, it's going to be 2.5 divided by 4.5. 0.556. 0.556. Okay. It's going to be equal to 5 over 9. Which one you prefer? This one, 5 over 9. You put everything together, you will get this one for 15.3 kilonewton. And then for the second case, you just put A sub Y 2. That is going to be smaller for sure. 8.1 times 1 plus this one, 10.8 times 5 over 9. And this one going to get a little bit smaller, 13.71 kilonewton. And then third, okay, A absolute maximum A sub Y equal to this one, 15.34 kilonewton. So just put this one for 15.34 kilonewton, okay. If you prefer, you may try to test for the B sub Y, and then you will get the same answer. Okay, next, we move find the absolute maximum bending moment, okay, of the girder. Okay, the first step, we are going to find F sub R. Okay, this one we finished already. F sub R. We have what? We have F sub R in this case is going to be 10.8 plus 8.1. That is going to be 18.9 kilonewton. So this one is going to be 18.9. And then the 18.9 supposed to be somewhere that is going to act over here, and F sub R is going to be 18.9 kilonewton. And then we got to set the reference point. Let's see, we set this one as the reference point, and this one is the X bar to be the location of the centroid of this F sub R. So then find the centroid. Second, find X bar. And then we have what? We have X bar equal to summation of F sub I curve divided by F sub R. And now this one is going to be 10.8 times 0, and then plus 8.1 times 2, and then divided by 18.9, divided by 18.9. You put it together, you supposed to get X bar equal to 0.857. This one, 0.857 meter. Okay, that is going to be 0.857 meter. And then what we have, we going to consider the beam into two cases. Okay, let's say the third for case one. For case one. Okay. Let's put the line of x bar over 2 is located at the mid span of the beam. Let me put in this writing. The line of x bar over 2, just check this is going to be the beam. This beam supposed to divide into two parts. Just put it into this position. This is called the midspan. This is going to call the midspan of the beam. And this beam is what? This beam has this support A as the roller and pin at the beam. Then we put this one into a half. Okay, we put this one into a half, and the distance here is going to be x bar over 2. The distance x bar over 2. The x bar is going to be 0.857 divided by 2, and this is going to be 0.4285. Okay, 0.4285 meter. So we will put this pink line over here. Okay. When we put this pink line over here, we going to put the green in this direction. So this is going to be 10.8. This is going to be 10.8. And let's see. This is going to be by this scale 4.5 per 50 millimeter. This is 0.4285. That is about 4.something millimeter. Just put the left for 4.something millimeter. And this F sub R is going to be this way. So this is going to be the F sub R equal to 18.9 kilometer. And then this is 10.8. Just put this one for 10.8 kilonewton. And then for 2 meter, that is going to be 22. So this is going to be the position. By using scaling is important. You will get this one, 22 millimeter. For this is 2 meter, right? This is going to be 8.1 kilonewton. Okay, using scaling is really important. By doing this, the load that's close to this mid span, that means the maximum moment will occur here. Okay, by doing this, just separate this one into half of 4.5 meter. That is going to be 2.25 meter. This is 2.25 meter. And this is the distance here. This is going to be the 0.4282. So if we put this one together, this is going to be 2.25 minus 0.4285. That is going to be 1.8215 meter. And the same thing as this one. This is going to be equal to 1.8 8215. Since the maximum going to maximum moment gonna occur here, that mean what? That mean we are going to determine, okay, to be easy, just determine A sub Y here, okay? We find A sub Y by summation of the moment. This time, we take the summation moment about B equal to zero. By doing this, A sub Y gonna rotate this way, plus A sub Y gonna have the difference here of 4.5. And then we are going to be equal to the 18.9. And that is going to have 1.8215 meter. And again, if you like, you may determine this one equal to 8.1 times something plus 10.8 times something. That is going to be the moment that come from all the loading, and this is going to be the moment that come from the resulting force. Okay, if you prefer, this one going to be the distance from here to here. Just check this one. This one from here to here is going to be 2.25. This is plus this one, plus 0.4285. Yeah. If you like to determine it, that is going to be equal to 2.6785 meters. So this is going to be 10.8 times 2.6785. And then if you know this, you just minus it. The distance from this two wheel is 2 meter. So you minus this is going to be 0.6785. Okay. If you do the same thing, you're going to get A sub Y equal to 34.426, about 34.4265, and then divided by 4.5, divided by 4.5. And then you get A sub Y equal to 7.65 kilonewton. Okay, this is going to be 7.65 kilonewton. And then just cut in this portion, determine the moment for the first case. This is going to be 7.65. This is going to be 10.8. Okay, the distance here is going to be 1.8215 meter. The moment is going to be here of M1, and we may draw this one for V1, and we find M1. By what? By the summation of the moment at this section equal to zero. Our M1, this is going to be positive. Our M1 is going to be equal to 7.65, and then times 1.8215. You get this M1. 13.93 kilonewton meter. We don't know yet it's going to be absolute maximum or not. We're going to check it for the second case. We come to the second case. Just draw the beam, but this time, this is roller. This is pin. This time our midspan is here. Okay, midspan is here. But this time we come to the distance here. Okay, we come to the distance here. Okay, the first for case two. Okay, the line of this time is the distance here. This is x bar. So this is going to be the distance of 2 minus x bar. So this is half of it, 2 minus x bar. Just let me put it into 2 minus x bar over 2. Half of it. That means we're going to divide this one by a half, okay? 2 minus x bar divided by 2, 2 minus 0.0857, and then divided by 2. And if you compute this one, it's going to be 0.5715, 0.5715 meter. The line of this one is located. The line of this one is located. Just put this one a little bit more. 2 point minus. This is 2.0857. That is going to be 1.143 meter. We have 1.143 meter divided by 2. We get this one is located. Is going to locate the same thing at the midspan. At the midspan of the beam. What I have is now we just put this line. This line is 1.143 divided by 2. That is going to be half of 0.57. So we put this yellow line over here, okay? And then we have the distance on the left and on the right of 0.5715. Just put it about 3 millimeter. Oh no, 5 millimeter. Millimeter. Just put it in 5. Just put this one 5 millimeter. And put this one 5 millimeter. What we have is this one, the yellow is here. So from the yellow to here, this is going to be 8.1 kilonewton. See, it chipped, right? And then the line on the left is going to be F sub R. So this one is going to be F sub R. Of 18.9 kilonewton. And then from here, there is what? There is 10.8. So 2 meter, just move it for 22 millimeter. From here, 2 meter, 22 meter. You get this one. For what? For 10.8 kilonewton. You see, they are different, the load pattern. From the first one and this one. And now, this one will have the load that's processed to the midspan. And this one will produce the maximum moment at under this one. By this means, we're going to determine this B sub Y. And now, we come to the same thing, phi. B sub Y. We find B sub Y this way. We just do the summation moment at A equal to 0. By doing this, what we have is this one again is separated into half of 4.5 meters. So this is going to be 2.25 meters. 2.25 meters. The distance here we did show you is 0.5715. When this is 0.715, we just deduct it by 2.25 minus 0.5715. This is going to be what? 1.6785. This is 1.6785 meter. And also the distance here to here is going to be 1.6785 meter. When you do this computation, you take the moment about a, V sub y rotate in this way is positive. This is going to be sub y times 4.5. This is going to be equal to 18.9. This one times 1.6785, and then you get the b sub y this way equal to 7.05 kilonewton. 7.05 kilonewton. That means what? This is going to be 7.05 kilonewton. And you got to use this portion to find M2. Then we find M2. This why M1, this why M2. You got to cut it over here. And now the B sub Y is 7.05 kilonewton. And this one is going to be 8.1 kilonewton. And we have this one for M, what? M2. Take moment here. Yeah. Summation of moment equal to zero. M2 equal to 7.05. This is 1.6785 meter times 1.6785. And then you get this one for 11.83 kilonewton meter, and then 5, you got what? Absolute maximum bending moment equal to 13.93 kilonewton meter. Okay, so no matter how big the point load is, maybe 3, maybe 4, or maybe even though 5, the step of calculation over here still the same. Okay, then always the same step going to be like this, and this is going to be the basis for what we support to learn. This is 13.93 kilonewton meter. Okay, let me move. I have another 15 minutes for the second problem, and we can work on this one very quick. Okay, just work on the problem. Now this problem have what? This problem have 15 meter simply supported beam. Let me have, this is going to be 7.5 meter. Let's put it into 7.5 meter. Put the beam into 7.5 meter. To make the scale 15 meter per 7.5 centimeter or 75 millimeter. This is the pin, this is the roller. This can ask us to determine absolute maximum shear. By this time, you got to do a lot of computation, but the first one, again, just draw the inference line of A sub Y. You put this one as the B. You move this one by the force A sub Y. Move this one for 1.0 unit. And then you get inference line of A sub Y. The problem is we are going to move this thing in a more comprehensive than the previous one. Since this time we have three loading, just have this one, one, and this one, two, and this one, three, and this one, So most of the time they're supposed to have four for absolute maximum shear. So what we supposed to do for each one of these, we going to consider to put the load by using the tile earlier method. The first one, I supposed to put the largest force over here. So just put this one, it's going to be 25 kilonewton. And by this scale, 2 meter, that's about, that is going to be 2 meter, 2 times 755, so 1 centimeter, okay? And that means it's going to be 1.5, okay? This is going to be 20 kilonewton. This is going to be 10 kilonewton, okay? 25 is at the maximum, okay? And another one may be possible by putting what? Putting, yes, 20 kilonewton here. And this one is going to be, this is going to be 3 meter. This is 2 meter. This is going to be 3 meter. You may put the 10 kilonewton. And this means we move this one here. And we can move another one in the opposite direction. Just put 10 kilonewton here. And this one is going to be 3 meter. This is going to be 20 kilonewton. And for another 1 meter, we're going to have this one for 25 kilonewton. Okay. And you may also move this one to be like this one for 20 kilonewton. This is 2 meter. This is for one. That is going to be 25 kilonewton. The 10 kilonewton is going to be here. The same thing over here. That is going to be 1 meter out. This is going to be 25 kilonewton. Okay, this move out of the beam, so we didn't consider it. And then for the first one, that is going to be sub A number one. So we have 25, and 25 gonna time 1 plus this one. Okay, this one plus 20 times the coordinate here. The coordinate here is going to be y1 over this one. This is 2 meter, right? This is going to be y1 over 13. This is 13 equal to 1 over 15. So this one going to be 13 over 15. And then about this one, you get this one for 2 meter and 3 meter. This one going to be y2 over this distance. This is going to be 10 meter and then 1 over 15. So you plus this one, 10, times what? Times 10 over 15, times 2 over 3. And then the first one, you get it for 45 kilonewton. Okay, that is for the first one. And for the second one, V sub A, the second now, 20, this one, 20 times 1. And how about this one? This one going to be project here. And this one will be Y3. This is going to be what? This is 3 meter. This is going to be 12 equal to 1 over 15. So Y3 is going to be 12 over 15 plus 10 times 12 over 15. You push them into the calculator. This one produce only 28 kilonewton. For the V sub A number 3, this one equal to what? 10 times 1. 10 times 1. And then plus this one, 20 times this one, 12 over 15, plus 25 times this one, 10 over 15. This one will provide you 42.67 kilonewton. And V sub A 4, if you do so, this is 20 times 1 plus 25 times this one, 13 point divided by 15. That is going to be 41.67 kilonewton. Thus, therefore, we have the absolute maximum shear force. This one, absolute maximum shear force. This one is absolute maximum shear force. Equal to this one, 49.4 kilonewton. So this one is 49 kilonewton. And then for the maximum, absolute maximum bending moment, we going to find the second one, F first. F sub R, what we have F sub R is going to be 25 plus 10 plus, sorry, plus 20 plus 10, that is going to be 55 kilonewton. And then the second X bar, we find X bar. We have what? X bar equal to what? Equal to is up to the reference. What we like to have, let's see, we have the reference here, and then our F sub R is going to be this one going to be F sub R is 55 kilonewton. And what we have for this one is going to be, this one going to be divided by 55. And since this is the X bar here, when you take the moment here, so 25 times 0 plus 20 times 2 plus 10 times 5. And then when you divide it, you're going to get it for 1.636 meter. Okay. And then for the first case, third, for case number one. Okay. That means we're going to what? We're going to put the half of this. We put half of this. Half of this is what? We put X bar divided by 2. Okay. That is 1.636. And then divided by 2. That is going to be 0.818 meter. Okay. We, for case one, put the X bar at put this one at the mid span of the beam. What we have is, again, we have 7.5 like this, and then we put it in a half. That is going to be about this. So this is going to be the midspan of our beam. We have this one for the pin. We have this one for the roller. We just put this one over here, and then you got 0.818. You may determine from this. That is going to be about about 4 millimeter. About this, that is going to be half of this. This is going to be 25 kilonewton. And then by the same, this, if you put this one about this one, this is going to be the next one. The next one is F sub R. This is going to be F sub R equal to 55 kilonewton. And then for this one is going to be for 2 meter. 2 meter. You get this one. X bar is this one over here. That is going to be 20 kilonewton. And then for 3 meter, on the scale, 3 meter, 3 times 7.5, divided by 15, 7.5 divided by 5 is about 1.5 something meter. Just put this. Okay, you got this one for 10 kilonewton. And then you can see the load that cross to the midspan is over here. So the maximum moment will occur over here. If the maximum moment occur over here, we will use this one as the free body diagram of this beam to determine the moment of M1, okay? And by doing this, we got to determine the A sub Y. And then by doing this, what we have from here to here is going to be 7.5 meter. This is 7.5 meter. And since we know that this hand here to be 0.818, so this one is going to be 7.5 minus 7.818. And then you get this for 6.682. This is 6.682 meter. Okay. And also, if you do get this, is also 6.682 meter. So by doing this, just summation of the moment about B equal to zero, A sub Y times 15, S minus it will equal to this one, equal to 55 times 6.682. And then you get A sub Y. By doing this, you get A sub Y equal to 24.5 kilonewton. So you put this one to 24.5 kilonewton. And then this one you find A sub Y, then you find M1, summation of the moment here to be zero. So M1 equal to 22.5 times what? Time the distance here is going to be 6.682 meter, 6.682. So you get the M1 equal to 163.71 kilonewton. And then come to the second one for case 1, 4, for case 2, okay? For case 2 again, what we do is now we draw the same beam as before, and now we just put half of this over here, and then we have this one for 7.5 meter, and this one again for 7.5 meter. But now we go back over here. There is a center between this. Let's see, the distance here is going to be 2 minus x bar. And then this is going to be 2 minus 1.6, 1.636. That is going to be 0.364. Okay. And then for second case, we put the 2 minus x bar divided by 2 equal to, we divide this by 2, 0.182, at the same thing, at the mid span of the beam. Okay, by this one, we gonna divide this by half, and then we put this one into this orange, and we put this orange over here. And then this one gonna divide into two things. One is going to be F sub R. This is going to be F sub R. F sub R. That's on the left is 55 kilonewton. And then there is another one is 20 kilonewton. Just put this one into 20 kilonewton. And the distance here is 0.182 meter. Okay, it's going to be here. And if you zoom it in, it's going to be something like this. And then there is 3 meter. You got to measure from 3 meter. That is going to be about this one. This is going to be 3 meter. 1.5. That's going to be 3 meter. And then we got this one of 10 kilonewton. This is 10 kilonewton. And from this to it is 2 meter. That is going to be 1.3. Okay, you got this one. This is going to be 25 kilonewton. And you can see they are different. And the location of the force that's close to the middle of the beam is going to be 20 kilonewton. And the maximum moment gonna occur here. And then now we find the B sub Y. So sub Y B sub Y. We do the summation of the moment about A is 0. B sub Y gonna time 15. And then it's going to be equal to this one. Okay. And this one gonna have the distance from here to here is equal to 55. And the distance here gonna be 7.5 minus this one, minus 0.182. And then you get this one for 7.318 meter. So this is gonna be 0.318. So you get the B sub Y equal to 26.63 kilonewton. This is 26.63, right? 83, sorry, 83. 83 kilonewton. And now you just cut this portion of the beam into our consideration. The 10 kilonewton is here. The 20 kilonewton is here. The distance here is 3 meter. And then from here to here is the same as this, is 7.318 meter. 7.318 meter. You get this one for 26.80 kilonewton. You got this one for M2. So you find M2 by summation of the moment. Okay, equal to 0. And then measurement here, the moment M2 plus 10 times 3 is going to be equal to 26.83 times 7.318. So M2 is going to be 166.36 kilonewton meter. Now you compare them, they are very close. This is going to be M1, and this is going to be M2, 163 and 166. And then number 4, absolute maximum M equal to 166.36 kilonewton meter. And that's all we have for today. And I will upload the video to you guys later. And now let's cover the chapter 6. Okay, for the normal situation, this is all we have for the midterm examination.